Hello, my name is Willow, and I am the host and creator of the Black Power Podcast, a podcast that explores Black history with a particular interest in the Black Power era of the 1960s. I am a student with a bachelor's degree in history, and I personally conduct and compile research for each episode. As always, sources used for the purposes of research will be listed in the episode description. Our first episode is a mini-episode in honor of Mardi Gras, which happened this past Tuesday, and we'll cover the voodoo queen herself, Marie Laveau. I hope you enjoy this mini episode, and I want to personally thank you for joining me. You can find the Black Power Podcast on SoundCloud, Apple Podcast, and YouTube. Let's get into this week's episode, Marie Laveau, the voodoo queen of New Orleans. Now, it's important to note that most of the information we have regarding Marie Laveau's life comes from first-hand or second-hand accounts from individuals who knew her or grew up hearing about her. There are very few primary sources to support many of the claims that have been made about her over the years. Semi-truths are abundant, and separating them from verifiable facts has proven to be difficult for historians. Today, Marie Laveau is world-renowned for her connection to the Crescent City and African voodoo culture. However, evidence presented by Carolyn Morrow Long, a retired researcher and conservator for the Museum of American History at the Smithsonian Institute, believes that for most of her time as a voodoo practitioner, Marie Laveau was not actually well known. Rather, it wasn't until her last few years of life that Laveau began to amass a following. By the time of her death in 1881, newspapers throughout New Orleans, including the New Orleans Daily Picayune and the Daily City Item, began to discuss Laveau's presence in New Orleans, describing her as a beautiful Creole, both charismatic and intelligent. Through my own research, I was able to find a number of articles that mentioned Marie Laveau before her death. The first source comes from the Daily State Journal, a newspaper out of Richmond, Virginia, which published an article on the 16th of April, 1873, regarding Laveau's presence as a spectator at a New Orleans criminal court. A witness stated, quote, "Her eyes had all the seeming of a demon that was dreaming," end quote. Another newspaper, the Opelousas Courier, a New Orleans French-language newspaper, wrote about a ceremony held by Laveau on July 5, 1873. This newspaper article discussed the experience of a reporter from the New Orleans Bee, who attended one of Marie Laveau's secret voodoo ceremonies at Bayou St. John on the 25th of June. As we can see, towards the end of her life, Marie had started to gain some attention in New Orleans, as well as throughout the country. Her mysterious and captivating persona had been crafted. Before we get into Marie Laveau's life as a voodoo practitioner and Creole queen, we need to talk about the unique history of the city of New Orleans. In 1682, the area which we consider to be modern-day Louisiana was claimed by explorer René Robert Cavalier, Sieur de La Salle, which roughly translates to Lord of the Manor, and I'll just point this out, my French is terrible, so I do apologize. And he claimed the territory on behalf of the King of France, Louis XIV. At this time, many European empires were fighting for a piece of the New World, and La Louisiane was France's piece of the South. Just a little over 30 years later, the city of New Orleans would be founded. The French chose this area of North America for the purpose of enforcing a monopoly on smuggling with the Spanish colonies further south and to the west. Funny enough, many French criminals were sent to Louisiana as an act of reform, which rarely happened. At this time, the area was full of professional privateers and smugglers from all over the Old World. Also, in attendance, Native American traders and enslaved workers. They all worked together for power, riches, and in some cases, their own personal freedom. In many ways, this was both the worst place to start a colony and the best. New Orleans is located at the mouth of the Mississippi River, before it drains into the Gulf of Mexico. It is the perfect location for trading. You could sail goods up and down the river from the St. Lawrence in Quebec to the Gulf and receive goods coming across the Atlantic directly, as would help with the slave trade. New Orleans was actually the largest and most active slave port in America at one point. However, New Orleans and the surrounding areas were all swampland, marshes, and expansive bayous. These conditions made it very hard for European settlers to live and establish themselves. The swampy areas brought hordes of insects and diseases, as well the city itself is almost 18 feet below sea level. And if it weren't vulnerable enough, the Gulf of Mexico is prone to hurricanes and flooding. New Orleans is literally an 18-foot bowl surrounded by two lakes, Pontchartrain and the Bighorn, the Mississippi, and the ocean. Yet, even with all this adversity, the colony was able to thrive. By 1720, the French had brought slaves from Africa, places like Senegal and the Congo, and had formed relations with indigenous tribes in the area. Another unique facet of the colony was its laissez-faire attitude to racial divisions. The French often reproduced and, in some cases, even married Native American locals or African slaves. The bizarre duality of French colonial life allowed for the creation of the first Free Society of Black People, or Gens de Couleur Libre, in the, I apologize again, in the New World, with people of varying ethnic backgrounds working side by side. When Marie Laveau was born, over 20% of New Orleans was home to free people of color. However, this laissez-faire lifestyle soon came to an abrupt end when in 1762, King Louis XV of France gave his cousin, Charles II of Spain, all the French land west of the Mississippi. In 1768, Louisiana colonists rebelled against Spanish rule. However, Spain regained control of Louisiana within a year. Then, in 1800, Spain secretly ceded Louisiana back to the French in the Treaty of San Ildefonso. And finally, in 1803, the Americans purchased Louisiana from Napoleon for $15 million, by doing so doubling the size of the United States. Amid all this territorial chaos, Marie Laveau's story begins. In 1801, Marie Laveau was born the illegitimate daughter of Charles Laveau, a wealthy white planter from France, and Marguerite d'Arcantel, a Creole woman of mixed heritage. It's important to note that new documents have been discovered regarding Marie Laveau's ancestral background, and researchers believe there is a possibility that both of Marie Laveau's parents might have been free people of color, but we don't know for sure. Creoles of New Orleans are a unique ethnic group of mixed race people. For this region, most Creole people are a combination of French, Spanish, African, and Native American. Of course, there are other ethnic groups that could be mixed in there, but this is the most common combination. Interracial marriages and relations were not uncommon in New Orleans. The city was notorious for allowing the most beautiful Creole women to marry rich white men. Even if it wasn't legal, it was allowed. White men outnumbered white women, and free women of color outnumbered free men. These race-based relationships between Creole women and white men were called placage, or placements. A Creole mother would organize a placement to ensure her daughter would be financially supported, believing a Creole woman would be better protected as a free person of color if she were to be associated with a white, wealthy man. Recently, however, there has been some pushback on these theories by a small handful of historians who believe these placements were rare occurrences. Of course, from these unions, mixed-race children were born. The more intricate the ethnic background, the more intricate the definitions for these people became. Terms like mulatto were for half-and-half kids, quadroon for quartered ethnicity, and octoroon for the racially ambiguous. Creole women during Marie's time often wore turbans used to show status because only free women of color would wear them. They were called madras because the colored cotton they used came from the Madras region of India. In the Daily State Journal, Marie Laveau was described as wearing a red shawl and faded yellow madras wrapped in the form of a turban. This description is the most commonly used image of Marie Laveau. These racial categories would change in the antebellum South and certainly after the Civil War. It soon became very confusing to define these people in society once Louisiana became an American colony because it went against the practice of segregation and social norms around race and hierarchy. A marriage certificate found at St. Louis Cathedral indicates at the age of 18, Marie Laveau married a Haitian man named Jacques Perry on August 4, 1819. Shortly after the ceremony, Jacques disappears from the records, yet his disappearance isn't documented as a death. It is widely believed that he left, but possible reasons for his departure are varied. Soon after, a few accounts state that Marie fell on hard times and may have even suffered a miscarriage. It is in this time of hardship that Marie Laveau's interest in the world of voodoo intensifies. She became a hairstylist, which aided her endeavors as she began to acquire massive amounts of knowledge on some of the city's most influential citizens. This information would become useful to Laveau as she began to craft her mysterious, all-knowing persona. Marie Laveau's ancestry played a big part in her practicing of voodoo. Rumor has it that Marie Laveau's great-grandmother was from the Congo. This great-grandmother passed down African traditions, including practices and knowledge that only mediums, priestesses, or shamans would know. Many first-hand accounts of Marie come from memories of New Orleanians who witnessed miracles performed by her. Some described her voodoo as witchcraft. Marie Laveau was said to have gone into possession trances and even possess other people. She, quote, made wives turn on their husbands and posh white ladies roll on the ground, end quote. It was said that she could cure fevers and illness. Interestingly enough, she was a fever nurse working at St. Louis Cathedral at the age of 14. She aided American and British soldiers during the Battle of New Orleans, as well as other people affected by cholera and yellow fever. Marie started working with a root doctor by the name of Dr. John, who is said to be a Senegalese prince. Under him, she began to learn the origins of voodoo. She perfected her craft, and by 1830, she was known as the Voodoo Queen, captivating crowds all over the city. She revolutionized religion by mixing voodoo with Christianity. She created her own brand of belief in the form of New Orleans voodoo, which incorporated African religion, Native American earth worship, and European Christian occultism. This was completely unheard of at the time. Surprisingly, she still kept her connections with the Catholic Church. Most likely, Catholics in New Orleans didn't mind that black people were incorporating voodoo into Catholicism, as long as people were still devout Catholics. It's important to mention that New Orleans at this time was a spiritual and mystifying place. And with the addition of free Haitians fleeing from the slave rebellions in Haiti, the city was filled with many voodoo believers. Many Wanga, African fortune tellers, and spiritual advisors flooded the streets around Congo Square. These Wangas had the power to put people in trances and interpret dreams. Voodoo was more than a religion. It was an integral part of life, especially in a city like New Orleans, where the spirituality of life, death, and magic played such an important role. People from New Orleans who had been children in the 1840s and 50s told interviewers from the Federal Writers Project, a Depression-era recovery program in the 30s, that they had seen Marie Laveau dancing and practicing voodoo at Congo Square. Congo Square is an open space in the Treme neighborhood where African and French music was played, there was dancing, and this is the spot where jazz was created. Marie Laveau held performances here for her followers. Hundreds of enslaved and free black people met and practiced voodoo at Congo Square. Authorities feared a slave uprising. At some point between the 1830s and 1850s, the city put up a set of iron gates around the square and closed it on Sundays, a common day for slaves and working black people to meet. It is believed by many that when the community demanded to have it reopened, somehow Marie was able to have the gates removed. Which brings us to an interesting aspect of Marie's influence. Along with her African ancestry, Laveau's French heritage seems to have played a major role in her so-called abilities as a voodoo priestess. Marie lived a dangerous secret life. It's believed that Marie had an underground network of informants, often servants or slaves, who provided information on the most influential people in the city. Her work as a hairstylist gave her the ability to talk to people who often worked for wealthy business owners and city officials. She also belonged to social aid and benevolent societies, and events organized by these clubs often served as occasions to collect intel. The Laveaus were also related to many prominent Catholic families throughout New Orleans, and Marie may have been able to get her way by pulling strings with these elites, who she often secretly counseled. She would have counseled the same people who she sought damning information on. One story details how Marie Laveau acquired her house on St. Anne Street in the French Quarter. She received her house from a wealthy man whose son was facing serious criminal offenses. The story goes as this. Marie walked to St. Louis Cathedral every day for 3 to 7 days, depending on which account you read. She prayed while holding 3 guinea peppers in her mouth for hours on end, and then she placed the peppers under the chair of the judge presiding over the case. The judge later dismissed the charges, the man went free, and his father gave Marie Laveau a house in 1832. Of course, we don't have any evidence to confirm that this exchange was the reason for Marie receiving her home, but it does demonstrate the general feelings about Marie's influence during the period. In terms of Marie's family life, she met a veteran of the Battle of New Orleans by the name of Jean-Louis Christophe Dumeny de Galipon. However, they were forbidden to marry as he was white. New Orleans had been a part of the United States for over 20 years at this point, and racial laws did not allow them to be together. So in response to this, he changed his race and pretended to pass as Creole. Evidence suggests that Marie and Jean-Louis had 5 children together. Their firstborn arrived on the 2nd of February, 1827, and she was baptized as Marie Galipon. Only she and another daughter survived childhood. This relationship worked out quite well, as Marie and Jean-Louis' family were connected to the highest French circles in New Orleans. The Galipon family was one of the first families of Louisiana, and Louis' grandfather was a French nobleman. As stated previously in the podcast, Marie Laveau most likely died in 1881, at the age of 80. Some documents suggest Marie Laveau was buried in an unmarked high tomb in St. Louis Cemetery 1. At least 9 other Laveau family members are buried there as well, and her tomb is one of the most visited in America. Many people today still visit Marie Laveau's grave, where they often write 3 X's on her tombstone as a way to signal a request from her or to offer prayers. Marie lived an extremely colorful life in a time when most women anywhere in the world couldn't even imagine having the freedom and power she acquired. Her story provides us with an indispensable glimpse into the multi-ethnic, multinational, and multilingual structure of colonial North America. So we still have a couple things to include in Marie's story. Anthropologist and writer Zora Neale Hurston interviewed Laveau family members throughout the early 20th century, and her writings on the family are thought to be the most extensive and accurate portrayal of 2 women. Who was this other woman, you may be wondering? Well, it's widely believed that after Marie Laveau's death, her daughter Marie Galipon changed her name to Laveau and took on her mother's role as voodoo queen. Many accounts from New Orleanians in the early to mid-20th century state that they personally witnessed Marie Laveau conducting spiritual practices on the beaches along Bayou St. John. Obviously, this would mean that Marie Laveau I would have been over 100 years old, if it was in fact her and not her daughter conducting these ceremonies. There are also clear distinctions between the 2 Maries, which help us to distinguish between the 2 voodoo queens. Marie II led voodoo in New Orleans after the Civil War, and she faced many challenges in this new America. The freedoms her mother enjoyed were long gone, and any French influence and social norms her mother depended on in order to maintain that freedom were replaced with American expectations and prejudices regarding race and segregation. Soon after her mother's passing, authorities in New Orleans passed laws that forbade fortune tellers and voodoo practitioners from openly practicing their religions and lifestyles. Thus, like the voodoo we are familiar with today, voodoo went underground, rarely being heard from. There are a few conclusive accounts as to what happened to Marie Laveau II after her mother's death. Some of these accounts state Marie II held nearly nude parties, inviting vast numbers of people to join in dancing, jazz, spirits, and beer on the beaches of Lake Pontchartrain. She was known for her ability to hypnotize, and it was widely reported that she owned a pet snake. Just like her mother, Marie II fell in love with a man she couldn't marry. Not because he was white, but because he was a successful Creole stockbroker who was already married. But you can't fight love, and they secretly had 5 children. Most of the information we have regarding Marie Laveau's life can most certainly be disputed. We must keep in mind that racial and religious prejudices from white society in New Orleans throughout the 19th and 20th century often led to descriptions of the Laveaus as witches or devil worshippers. It is quite possible that city and local officials tried to scrub Laveau's influence from the city by getting rid of any documentation, essentially making her a figure of fiction. For example, writer and historian Robert Talent published a book in 1946 called Voodoo in New Orleans. He used statements from various individuals to argue that Marie Laveau and all practice of voodoo was a negative, devil-worshipping religion. Statements included the sacrificing of children by turning them into black cats and the drinking of blood by voodoo practitioners in regular ceremonies. While many people in New Orleans disagree with this portrayal, Talent's imagery of Laveau and voodoo stuck for many decades. Marie Laveau lived a unique duality. She was Creole, born 3 years prior to France ceding the colony to America. She was a Catholic French citizen who only spoke French and adhered to French laws and governance, all the while being an involuntary citizen of a predominantly Protestant English country with strict laws on race and social hierarchy. We will most likely never know the complete story of Marie Laveau's life. Her story is one that twists and turns through history with little tangibility. Yet from the remarkable accounts we do have, we can conclude that no one has had such a dynamic hold on a city, quite like the Voodoo Queen of New Orleans. Thank you for joining me for this mini episode. If you are interested in learning more about the culture and history of New Orleans, I encourage you to visit the city's many museums. I had the privilege of visiting the New Orleans Historic Voodoo Museum, Marie Laveau's House of Voodoo, and the Presbytère and Cabildo, both of which are a part of the Louisiana State Museum. As well, I had the pleasure of visiting the library at Loyola University, and I was able to do a little bit of research while I was there. For visual sources, I recommend watching American Experience New Orleans, which is available through PBS. You can also check out the television show Tremé, which follows a number of characters through their trials and successes as they rebuild from Hurricane Katrina. Tremé is also available on HBO. And you should definitely see Spike Lee's When the Levees Broke, which is an amazing documentary that touches upon the disaster of Hurricane Katrina, but also the history of New Orleans. Thank you for joining me this week. As always, you can find the Black Power Podcasts on SoundCloud, Apple Podcasts, and YouTube. I would love to hear from those of you listening, so please leave a comment or a review. You can follow us on social media. We're on Instagram and Twitter at the Black Power Pod. If you have an episode idea or topic, please feel free to email theblackpowerpodcast@gmail.com. Have a wonderful day, and I'll see you next week.